So you will get the data of 16, 17, 18, 19. The same way for the balance sheet also, if you try and convert that into annual numbers, this is how it would look like. And I hope you have done this exercise. If you have not done, you will have to do this exercise. Cash flow statement, they have given for three different years. So you can do for the three different years also, or you can have a combined also, depending upon your choice. Now, what you have to do in financial statement analysis assignment is basically, you have to do trend analysis. So you have to do two types of analysis. One is called the percentage analysis, and second is called the trend analysis, which is called the change analysis. So vertical analysis and horizontal analysis. These are the two analysis that you are supposed to do. Let's just understand how to convert the data into it. So percentage analysis ke liye sabse important cheez ye hai, you have to convert all the items as a percentage of sales in income statement. So what I've done is, for 2016, let's say, for 2016, I have converted all items of 2016 as a percentage of net revenues, right? So cost of sales is 91% of the revenue. Gross margin is 8% of the revenue. Employee benefits are 2.65% of the revenue. So what you have to do is, you have to simply apply an Excel formula, the cell divided by the same cell in the log. So if you drag it down, the bottom cell will remain constant and top cell will change. So this is how you have to convert for 2016. The same way I have done for 2017 also. So 2017 May, the revenue number was 4484. So the cost of sales will be 80%. Sorry. Cost of sales would be 80% of the revenue. So what I've done is, I've done for 16, 17, 18, and 19. Please remember, every year, the revenue that you have to assume 100% will be different, right? And convert all expenses as a percentage of revenue. Did you understand? If you can say or give me a nod, I'll be able to help. Please turn on your camera and nod if you understood this. What I have done is, I have converted all the expenses as a part of revenue by assuming revenue as 100%. For example, in 2016, the COGS was 91% of the revenue. In 2017, it fell down to 80%. In 2018, it is 77%. And in 2019, it is 78%, right? This is called the percentage analysis. So we are trying to convert all dollar values into percentage values for better comparison, right? Once you move that, after that, you have to do something called a change analysis. So change analysis is basically how much that particular number has changed from the past year. So if you could look for 2017 ke liye, the number is 17 divided by 16 minus 1. So from 2016 to 2017, what was the percentage increase in the revenue? So what I have done is, 2017 number, the current number, divided by the past number minus 1. So the growth rate in revenue was 79%. Same way I did it for 2018 also, right? And this number was 39%. And in 2019, I could see a fall in sales, because 2019 ka sale number is less than 2018 ka sale number, right? So in this case, what I have done is, I've done something called a change analysis, right? Did you understand the change analysis, how it is done? You have a base year and you have a next year. Now you can see one difference. The data is for 5 years, 16, 17, 18, 19, and 20. So percentage analysis you can do for all 5 years, but change analysis you will be only able to do for 4 years. Why? Because in order to do the change analysis, you need to have one base year. So for 16, you need data of 2015, which is not available. So you have to start from 17. So this is the change analysis, right? In addition to change analysis, you see, let's do an analysis. Sales number was 79%, then it fell down to 39, then minus 3 and 7.68. Suppose you want to take a decision that whether the sale number was good or bad, it's not possible because all numbers are different. So for that, there is one more measure that you have to calculate, which is called CAGR, compounded annual growth rate. So compounded annual growth rate कैलकुलेट करने के लिए व्हाट यू नीड इज द डेटा हैज टू बी डिस्ट्रीब्यूटेड. कंपाउंडेड एनुअल ग्रोथ रेट का फॉर्मूला है करंट ईयर डिवाइडेड बाय द फर्स्ट ईयर raised to the power 1 divided by the number of years minus 1. See, if I could show you how the CAGR is calculated, 2020 is the last year. 2016 was the base year. So 2020 divided by 2016 whole raised to the power 1 divided by number of years between these two. So 1, 2, 3 and 4. There are 4 periods between these two. From financial year 16 to financial year 20, there are 4 periods. 16 to 17, that's 1. 17 to 18, that's 2. 18 to 19, that's 3. And 19 to 20, that's 4. Right? So the data has to be calculated. CAGR ka formula kya hai? Bracket 2020 divided by 2016. The whole bracket raised to the power 1 divided by number of periods, which is 4, bracket over minus 1. This will give you compounded annual growth rate. Compounded annual growth rate means on an average yearly growth rate kitna tha. See, the numbers are not very great. 79 or minus 3.4, dono number hai. So you have both the extreme. So in order to avoid the decision problem, you have to calculate something called CAGR. So CAGR aapko ye batayega ki overall positive growth hai, overall negative growth hai, and all that. Now, once you calculate this for all, you can do the analysis and you can talk about it. So once you do this, you can straight away move to the analysis. So CAGR for sales was 26.91%. See, you are observing two things. In 17, the growth rate was very high. In 18 also, there was a positive growth rate. But in 19, the sales growth rate is negative. So sales have fallen, right? Again, it has gone up. So it's an unusual trend. Now, when you have an unusual trend, you cannot take decision based on trend, but you have to calculate the CAGR, the average number. And you can write an observation that sales growth is unusual. However, CAGR is positive. Sales growth unusual hai, but CAGR positive hai, iska matlab hai, on an average, yearly basis pe 26% growth rate aapne observe kiya hai. Right? Now, second observation is about the COGS. COGS mein you can observe two things. See, COGS as a percentage of sales is falling. Earlier it was 91%, then it dropped down to 80, then it dropped down to 77, and now it is kind of fixed. So what happened earlier, 91% of your revenue went into expenses. You have developed a good model, you have reduced the COGS, and now it is only 78%. So the observation that you can write is COGS percentage is going down consistently. It is a good expense management, right? So something like that you have to do for all the things. Now, let's say the third thing, if I would like to talk about gross margin. So what is happening to the gross margin? If you look at the numbers, gross margin is consistently improving. So gross margin is improving. It's a good sign. Gross margin as a percentage of sales is also increasing. That's also a good sign. And gross margin in terms of change is not very well. But if you do the CAGR, roughly 58% of growth is observed. So gross margin is increasing. Now, why gross margin is increasing? The simple reason is you are able to manage COGS very well. That's why your gross margin is increasing. So aapko jo analysis karke observation likhna hai na, usme aapko diagnose karna hai. Gross margin consistently kyun badh raha hai. So gross margin is increasing because you are able to manage COGS. Your cost of goods sold is going down. The sales growth is also going up. And you have observed one thing. Your sales growth is 26%, but your expense growth is 22%. Which means your sales are growing 26% on an annual basis, but your expenses are not going exactly equal to that. Means you are doing a better expense management job. And that is the reason your gross margin is increasing. Right? Now, if we talk about certain expenses, I've done the analysis for the other expenses also. So what you have to do is look at the trend analysis. Now for this, let's say if you talk about this, the percentage is very low. The chain number are not very great because this expense does not have a much of the amount. So what happens is when the expense amount is not very great, doing a change analysis will not help बिकॉज एक से दो होता है तो इट इज अ ग्रोथ ऑफ 200%. So change analysis will not be useful when the numbers are not changing very frequently. So if you can look at automobile expenses, numbers are not changing very great. Bank service charges are not doing. But you can see that employee benefit may, the numbers are changing and they are very good also. For example, earlier you used to pay employee benefit in terms of, let's say, provident fund contribution or gratuity or something like that. It was 66. Now it has gone down to 22. So you can see the expenses are going down. Look, expenses as a percentage of sales is also going down. It was earlier 2.65%. Now it has gone down to roughly 33%. And if you could see the change analysis also, it is negative. So year on year basis, the expenses are going down. The CAGR of expenses is also going down, which means that on an average, you are reducing these expenses at the rate of 25% per year, which is a good sign because employee benefit is an expense for the company. And if you're able to decrease the expense, it's a good sign. So again, I've given a green line. Employee benefits are going down. It indicates better employee management. So what you have to do is you have to make an observation. If because of this expense or revenue, if there is a positive sign to the company or if there's a benefit to the company, you have to highlight as a green. For example, employee benefit expenses are going down. So it's an advantage for the company. So I've given it as a positive green tick. But in this case, the expenses are going up, which is not a good sign. So I've given a negative tick. Same way you can do for all other expenses. You have to try and see that whether there is a phenomenal difference. For example, salary and wages, 750, say it has gone down to 357, which means earlier you used to pay $750 as a salary to the employees. Now it has gone down to 357. So what is happening? Salary as a percentage of revenue was 30%. Now it has gone down to roughly 5%. So you are able to manage the salary expense very well. So going down indicates better employee management, same with the other thing. And you can do the analysis for rest of the file also. I'm going to share this file for your advantage and for your purpose. So you have to do the expense management and ultimately you have to see whether the total operating expenses are going up or down. So total operating expenses are kind of stable. Neither it was 1605. Then it went down, then it went down, and finally it's kind of a stable. So what we can see is operating expense as a part of revenue was 65% roughly. Now because of better operating expense management, it has gone down to roughly 18%. So that's a positive sign. So you can write that going down is a good sign. So this is how you can do the analysis for the income statement. You can see the net income was earlier negative. So you used to have losses. Now you have shifted to profit. So this is a very, really very good sign that entity which was into a depression, which used to have a negative revenue or income had gone down and now it has improved. So overall, what you have to do, expense by expense, do the diagnosis, see whether the trend is upward, downward, see the percentage analysis and give your conclusion. Now, suppose I have to conclude broadly about income statement, I can figure out 3-4 things. One, that sales are increasing, it's a good sign. Second, most of the expenses are managed very well, so that's also a good sign. And because of that, the profit is increasing, so that is also a good sign. So suppose I have to advise somebody to invest in this company based on purely income statement analysis, I can advise them that yes, you can invest in this company because this company was actually in the loss, but now they have shifted into profit because of better expense management. So they have done some good amount of exercise and they've reduced their expenses and converted their losses into profit. This is how you can do the income statement analysis, percentage analysis and trend analysis. So percentage analysis is basically your vertical analysis and chain analysis is basically your trend or horizontal analysis, right? So if you would give me a nod that you understood what I was saying, I'll be happy. Did you understand how things work? It's very simple. Don't worry, I'm recording. Sir. Yeah, I'm recording this lecture also and I'm going to share the file also.
Yes, sir.
Fine. Okay, let's move to the balance sheet now. You can mute yourself. Please mute yourself. Yeah. Now, same way, balance sheet is prepared for 4 years. So in this example, they have given me the data for 4 years. So I've done the percentage analysis for 4 years and the trend analysis is only for 3 years. Trend analysis is 3 years because you have 4 years data and 2016 is a base year, right? So you cannot have. Now the same way I did the percentage analysis, the only difference is here you will do the analysis in total assets or total liabilities. See, you remember that balance sheet is always matching. So total assets are equal to total liabilities. So when you convert all the items, it should be either part of total assets or total liabilities. So what we'll do is, we'll assume total assets as 100% and try and convert everything as a percentage of total assets. Let me give you an example. Cash and cash equivalents in 2016 was 811, right? So 811 is what percentage of 890? So I've done this in the Excel, right? So 811 divided by dollar sign of 890. The dollar sign is an absolute cell reference. So when you drag it down, the denominator will remain constant, only the numerator will change. So I've done the cash analysis and I come to know that cash is 91% of the total asset. Same way, if I would like to talk to, let's say, prepaid. So prepaid is only 0.75% of the total assets. Fixed assets are 7.82% and so on. The way I did the analysis for 2016, I can do the same analysis for 2017, 18, 19. Now let's observe something. In 2016, the cash was 91% of the assets. In 2016, the cash was 91% of the assets. Now it has gone down to 86. Then it has gone even further to 63. And now it has came back as 89%. So there is an unusual trend. So when there is an unusual trend, neither you have a growth nor you have consistent decline, it's very difficult to take a call. And that's where you have to calculate something called a CAGR, right? The same way I did the change analysis also. If someone can mute themselves, somebody has unmuted. Yeah. Somebody has unmuted themselves. Please mute. Yeah. The change analysis is very simple. What was the year-to-year change? So again, if I have to go for 17, so 17 divided by 16 minus 1. In 2016, the cash balance was 811. In 2017, it is 617. Right? So the change analysis says that there was a decrease of 23% in cash. Same way, 15.72% increase and 60. Now, for unusual numbers, minus, plus, and super plus, you have to calculate something called a CAGR, compounded annual growth rate. Compounded annual growth rate, the same mechanism, right? But instead of 4 years, now you have 3 periods, because 3 periods ka hi growth aapke paas available hoga. Since there is a 4 years data, the periods between 16 and 19 is 1, 2, and 3. So there is a 3-period data, right? So you have to do the, now comments, cash balance is increasing. It's a good sign. Same way, if you want to do the analysis for, let's say, accounts receivable was not there in 2 years. In 18 and 19, you had, from 18 to 19, there is a huge decline. But the problem is, it's only the data of 1 year. So you cannot make any judgment when you have only 1 year's data. Because in 1 year's data, you cannot do any trend analysis. For trend analysis, at least you should have a data of 2 to 3 years. However, accounts receivable has gone down. So it's a good sign that you are able to recover. So all accounts receivable is going down. Faster collection, it's a good sign. Can I request somebody to mute? Because I don't know. I'm still getting the noise. Can you please look at your mic and mute yourself? I'm still getting the disturbance. I don't know.
Shweta, you have to mute yourself. Yeah. Yes, sir.
Yeah. So accounts receivable, it's a 93% decline. Now, 93% decline in accounts receivable means it's a very good sign. But unfortunately, it's only for 1 year. So we cannot make any conclusion. However, since it has gone down, it's a positive sign, right? So you have to ensure two things. For trend analysis or for change analysis, you should have at least data of more than 2 periods. Then only some comparables can be done. Same way, I have done the analysis for all the assets and liabilities. And I could see, let's do some analysis. So prepaids are increasing. So prepaid is basically when you pay the expense in advance, like prepaid insurance and all that. So what is happening in 2016, the prepaid was 7. Now it has gone up to 24. Now it has gone to 34 and 42. The indication of this is that you are paying so many expenses in advance. Now that's not a good sign because it's a drain in the cash. Whenever you are paying expense in advance, cash is going out from your business. There may be some strategic reason that you would like to pay the expenses in advance, but still it's a problem. So if prepaids are increasing, there is a drain in the cash. However, since prepaid is an asset, asset is increasing. That's why I have given a green sign. So when you do the analysis, you have to think from both the point of view. Prepaid is an asset, an increasing asset is always good. But if because of that, there is a cash outflow or cash issue, then you have to do the analysis slightly different. So in this case, when we do the cash flow statement analysis, we'll compare that whether because of prepaid, the cash flow is significantly affected or not. Right? So for time being, prepaid, since it's an asset, it is increasing, I agree it is a green or a positive observation. Now let's look at the total current assets. So total current assets are increasing. Total current assets are increasing. It's a good sign, right? Now what is the reason? So current assets are increasing. And if we can just try and see the observation. Current assets are increasing because of a very high cash balance. Every year, the cash is going up. And that is the reason current assets are increasing, right? Now cash has two problems. If you have too much cash, it is unproductive, and if you have too less cash, it will create a financial crisis. So you have to identify what is the optimum level of cash, and that depends upon the strategy of company and what amount of cash you want to keep it and all that. So for that, you have to go a little bit deeper. You cannot make a judgment only from the financial statement. But the bottom line is, if you have too much cash, it means cash is unproductive and you are not investing it into a productive resource. You have to invest in a marketable security, which will generate some return. Cash per se does not generate any return, right? So that's the idea. Second is, if you do the liability analysis, so we are seeing that accounts payables are increasing. Now accounts payable are increasing means you are stretching the payments, right? If you're stretching the payments, it's a good sign because you are using credit for your business. So your cash is protected. But on the flip side, accounts payable is increasing means your current liabilities are also increasing. So whenever there is a current liability increase, you have to compare it with the current asset. There is no problem if your current liabilities are increasing, if your current assets are also increasing. But if your current assets are stable and your current liabilities are only increasing, then there is a problem. Right? So when you do the analysis of current liabilities, always try and compare with the current assets. Now, if you do the item analysis, if accounts payable is increasing, it means you are purchasing a lot on credit, which means you are saving a lot of cash. That's a positive sign. But if you have too much of accounts payable, means you are creating too much of current liability, which may affect your function and it may affect your liquidity also. Right? Client credit, the same thing. Deferred revenue is basically when customers pay you in advance, but you have not performed the services. Let me give you an example. Suppose you have paid the third semester fees to us. So it's a deferred revenue for SBS because you have paid the fees, but we are yet to provide you the services. Now, deferred revenue is a source of cash. It brings cash into the business, but it's also a liability. Unless you don't perform the services, you cannot record it as a revenue. So deferred revenues are increasing, right? So increasing, it's not a good sign because deferred revenue ke case mein kya hai? You are collecting cash from the customer, but your liability is also increasing, right? Teachers payable, I think something, some amount of payment related stuff is always there. So if the liabilities are increasing, it's not a good sign, right? Now let's look at some other item. Anything on this capital and shareholders? So earlier shareholders' equity was plus, then it went negative for 2 years because there was a loss for consistently 3 years, and then you have some profit and all that. So nothing great to observe. So when you do the balance sheet analysis, you have to do 3 kinds of analysis. What is the type of asset? What is the percentage of that asset as a total asset or a liability? And look at the trend and comment based on the trend. For example, if current assets are increasing, it's a good sign. If current liabilities are increasing, it's not a good sign, right? So these are some general observations, and there are some item-based observations also. So this is how you can do the balance sheet analysis item-wise. And whenever you do the item analysis, you just try and see whether it's increasing, stable, or decreasing. And you can also take a help of CAGR. If CAGR is too good, for example, in case of prepaid, the CAGR is 85%. So that's a good sign. The prepaids are increasing, the asset is increasing, right? So when you do the analysis, make sure that percentage, change, and CAGR, all three analyses has to be done. Okay, now let's move to the final phase of the analysis, which is called cash flow statement. Now, if you remember cash flow statement, there are three items: cash flow from investing, cash flow from financing, and cash flow from operation. Now, if you remember, there was, how did you recalculate cash flow from operation? Was we start with the net profit, we add back non-cash charges like depreciation and amortization, and then we adjust for working capital. So if you could remember, decrease in the asset and increase in the liability was a source of cash. So it's a positive sign. It will bring the cash. And increase in the asset and decrease in the liability was use of cash, which was negative. Now, decrease in the asset and increase in the liability, ye do cheeze hain, it is only related to current assets and current liabilities. Right? It's not related to fixed asset. Aapko ek cheez agar main bataun, fix to balance sheet mein, the asset side of the balance sheet mein, long-term assets will go in investing, short-term assets will go in operation. In liability side, long-term liabilities will go in financing and short-term liabilities will go in operations. So whenever I'm talking about cash flow from operation, I'm only interested in current assets and current liabilities. So what I have to do is I have to check whether there is a decrease in the asset or increase in the liability. If these two things are there, then it's a source of cash. It's a positive sign. Cash flow is coming in the business. And if there is increase in the asset and decrease in the liability, it is use of asset. See, I'll give you an example. Decrease in the asset means, suppose you have something called debtors. Debtor is an asset for you. When debtors will decrease? When they pay you. So when debtors are decreasing, it's a source of cash. Increase in the liabilities, creditors. So when creditors will increase? When you don't pay them. So when you don't pay them, you save the cash, and cash saved is a source of cash. This is how the general logic of the analysis will go. Now, let's just try and see how things are moving. For example, accounts payable, negative. Now, when can accounts payable be negative? See, accounts payable can be positive when you are getting a credit. And accounts payable will be negative when you are paying. So what happened in 2018, you had to pay some accounts. Oh, sorry, accounts receivable. Yeah. So accounts receivable is basically when you receive the cash from the debtors. So in 2019, you received 284, and in 2018, you created accounts receivable of 303. Now, when you create accounts receivable, it means you are not receiving the cash. So when you are not receiving the cash, it's a negative sign. It's a drain on the cash. Same way, prepaid expenses. Every year, you have created prepaid expenses. So it's a negative sign. Now, why it is a negative sign? Since it's an asset, you have to purchase that asset, and for purchasing that asset, cash has to go out from your business. So this is treated as negative, right? Accounts payable is something which you are supposed to pay. So accounts payable minus one represents that you have paid, and plus represents that you have created a credit purchase. Whenever accounts payable are increasing, it means you are purchasing goods on credit. And whenever you are purchasing goods on credit, you are saving some cash. And when you are saving some cash, it's a source of cash. So whenever you do the analysis of each item, you have to understand whether it is negative or positive. Negative means there is a cash outflow, and positive means there is a cash inflow. Client credits, deferred revenue, and all the teachers payable. Same way, investing activity, computers and equipment, minus 4 means you have purchased it, and plus 4 means you have sold it. So when you purchase an asset, it's an outflow. And when you sell an asset, it's an inflow, right? With case of furniture and equipment, minus 4 means you have purchased an asset. So there was minus 8, which means purchase of an asset, and plus 4 means selling of an asset. There is no financing cash flow. So ultimately, if you could see negative, negative, plus, plus, and at the beginning, so this is the cash flow reconciled. So when you do the analysis, you have to make an observation. For example, you're doing more prepaid expenses. So it's a cash outflow, right? It's not a good sign. You're doing more credit purchases. It's a good sign because it is saving some cash. Client credits are also increasing, means clients are paying you in advance, right? Clients are paying you in advance. It's a good sign, but it is creating a liability. But when you consider from purely from the cash flow point of view, it's a good sign because it is bringing the cash. Teachers payable, again, it's positive. So when you do the cash flow analysis, you have to identify the activities which are contributing towards cash, and you are identifying the activities which are draining the cash, and you have to do the common observation. So for each income statement, balance sheet and cash flow, you have to do the item wise observation and tell us whether it will have a positive impact on the company or it will have a negative impact on the company. This is called the observational analysis. So when you do the financial statement analysis, trend analysis or scenario analysis or percentage analysis, each item's change or trend has to be recorded and you have to figure out whether this trend will lead to positive impact on the company or negative impact on the company. When you do the analysis of all three items and you come to know that most of the analysis or changes are positive for the company, you can advise your client to invest in this company. Right? Now, ये आपने किया फर्स्ट लेवल का एनालिसिस. नाउ टू सपोर्ट दिस एनालिसिस देयर इज अ सेकंड लेवल ऑफ एनालिसिस व्हिच यू हैव टू डू. लेट मी शेयर दैट आल्सो व्हिच इज वेरी कॉमन एंड वी ऑल नो दैट इज कॉल्ड रेशियो एनालिसिस. सो व्हाटएवर यू हैव कैलकुलेटेड थ्रू योर हॉरिजॉन्टल एंड वर्टिकल एनालिसिस इन ऑर्डर टू सब्सटेंशिएट योर क्लेम एंड इन ऑर्डर टू सी वेदर इट हैज अ बेटर मीनिंग यू हैव टू डू समथिंग कॉल्ड अ रेशियो एनालिसिस. नाउ आई हैड सेंड यू दिस मटेरियल roughly 1 week back, but I'm going to share it today also. This material is all about the financial ratios. So what you have to do is you have to calculate the ratios for 3 or 4 years and look at the trend. Now there are mainly 5 types of ratios: profitability ratio, leverage ratio, efficiency ratio, liquidity ratio, and ratios related to valuation. Now we'll not be able to go through the entire ratio because we have already done in financial statement analysis. So I'll broadly tell you what to do. So first category of ratio is called profitability ratio. Now this ratio tells you that how profitable is your company. So you have to calculate certain measures like return on equity, return on assets, return on capital employed, gross margin, operating margin, and net profit margin. Please remember, profitability ratios, if they are increasing year to year, it's a good sign, which means your profitability is increasing. If they are going down year to year, that's not a good sign. And if they are stable also, that is also a good sign. So profitability ratio mein aapko ye dekhna hai ki if they are going down year to year, that's not a good sign. If they are going up year to year, absolutely good. And if they are stable also, then also it's good. So that's about profitability ratio. This document has all the formulas and all that you can take. When you talk, let's say you calculate a net profit margin. So for 1 year it is 10%, for second year it is 20%, for third year it is 30%, and for fourth year it is 40%. So the trend is positive. So when you have a positive trend in net profit margin, it's a good sign. That is how you have to do the analysis. Second category of ratio is leverage ratio. Leverage ratios are basically ratio related to debt. Leverage means use of debt in your capital structure. The advantage of debt is it is cheaper compared to equity, and the disadvantage of leverage is that it is a compulsion to pay the interest, right? So what you have to do is you have to calculate 3 ratios. One is called debt to equity ratio, second is called equity ratio, and third is called debt ratio. This ratio probably you will be able to read. These two we have done, which is called debt to equity and debt. Leverage ratio tells you what is the proportion of your firm financed by the debt holders, right? So suppose your leverage ratio is 50% and in the next year it improves to 75%, it's not a good sign because it means your debt holders are financing your firm more compared to the equity holders. Among all the ratios, leverage ratios are the only ratios, if they are improving, it's not a good sign. Leverage ratio has to go down, or at least it should be stable. If it is going down, it's a good sign. If it's stable, that is also a good sign. But if they are increasing, that's not a good sign. So that's the story of leverage ratio. The third is efficiency ratio, which is also called asset utilization ratio. This efficiency ratio basically indicates that how efficiently you are utilizing assets to generate sales, right? So efficiency ratios are also called the activity ratios, that how efficiently you are doing your activity. Some of the prominent ratios are accounts receivable and asset turnover ratio and inventory turnover ratio. Now you have to remember there is a turnover ratio and there is a days ratio, and these two have an inverse relationship. Higher the turnover, lower will be the days. Let me give you an example. Suppose your inventory turnover ratio is high, then your days sales inventory will be lower. Now both of the things are advisable. The turnover ratio has to be as high as possible and days ratio should be as low as possible. So when you calculate inventory turnover ratio, debtors turnover ratio, it has to increase. But when you calculate the creditor's turnover ratio, it has an opposite connotation, that it has to decrease. So when you read this ratio, you will be able to understand that activity ratios will indicate how efficiently you are utilizing assets. Now, efficiency or activity means you would like to have a more turnover. For example, inventory turnover ratio is increasing. It means you are selling more inventory. Debtors turnover ratio is increasing. It means you are receiving more money from debtors. But if creditors turnover ratio is increasing, it means you are paying more. So creditors turnover ratio has to compare with debtors turnover ratio, and then you have to make a judgment, right? So this is about efficiency ratios. Normal connotation, if these ratios are improving, it's a good sign, right? Finally, liquidity ratio, which is called the working capital ratio. So current ratio, quick cash, and all other ratios. So you can try and look at the ratios. These ratios generally indicate how much liquidity you have if your short-term liabilities are due for payment today. So the only thing you have to do is, if these ratios are improving on a year-to-year basis, your liquidity is better. If these ratios are going down on year-to-year basis, your liquidity is not very good. If these ratios are stable, that's also fine. So in this analysis, you have to ensure whether this liquidity is going up or down. Normally, the only flag area is if these ratios are going down, that's not a good sign. Finally, you have something called a valuation ratio. This is a price to earnings ratio we have done. You cannot calculate these three ratios for any firm because you don't know what is the EV to EBITDA concept. But instead of this, I'll tell you what to calculate. So what you are expected to calculate is additional set of ratios, which are these. So what you can do is you can calculate these ratios you have to calculate. So one is price to earnings ratio. It tells you that for every $1 of earnings per share, how many times markets are valuing your firm. Then projected earnings growth is year to year earnings growth. Price to sales ratio is market price per share divided by the sale. Price to book value ratio, dividend payout ratio, dividend book value, and all that. Now, all these ratios are explained in my material as well as the material that I'm going to send. Or you can also look at this ratio's definition in Investopedia. Now, what you have to do is you have to calculate all these ratios for 3 to 4 years. And then you have to see the trend. For example, if your price to earnings ratio is increasing, it's a good sign. If it is decreasing, it's not a good sign. If your dividend yield is increasing, it's a good sign. If dividend yield is not increasing, that's not a good sign. If return on equity is increasing, it's a good sign. If return on equity is decreasing, it's not a good sign. So what you have to do is, basically, in this assignment, you have to do the percentage analysis. You have to do the trend analysis. You have to write your observation. You have to calculate the ratios. And you have to do your observation. So now when you do the assignment, what you have to do is, the original file which I have sent was into monthly. So first, convert the data into yearly for all three statements, for income statement, balance sheet, and for cash flow statement. Then do the percentage analysis and observations for each statement, right? For balance sheet and for cash flow, do the observation analysis. Once you do the observation analysis, calculate the ratios and different ratios and talk about the trend. And once you do this, give us 10 or 5 or 10 reasons why you think this company is a good investment opportunity. Whether you are advising your client to buy this company or whether you are advising the client to not buy in this company based on your analysis. So the analysis will be fundamental analysis, which is balance sheet, income statement, and cash flow statement, percentage analysis, and trend analysis, supported by the ratio analysis, right? Everywhere after your computation, you will have to write the observation. And once you write the entire observation, in 5 or 10 bullet points, you have to advise me and Rinky ma'am whether this company, as an analyst, whether you advise your client to invest in this company based on your analysis or not. This is the second phase of analysis, which is called financial statement analysis. Okay, now you can turn on the camera, and if you have any questions, we can address. So did you understand the process? Please nod. Please turn on your camera and nod.
Yes.
You don't have to speak, you nod only. Acha, kitne logon ne wo file convert kiya hai?